Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Welcome to the panel, Confronting Climate Change Solutions for a Sustainable World. My name is Jill Soam. I'm an associate professor of teaching and the director of the Environmental Studies program here at USC. It's a real pleasure to get to be with this group of people and to moderate this panel today. And thank you all so much for being here. It's my goal for today that you come away learning something new about climate change, about sustainability, and hopefully coming away feeling hopeful for the future. So let's start by introducing our distinguished panelists. We have Jennifer Bernstein over on the end. She's a lecturer at the Spatial Sciences Institute at USC. She studies contemporary environmentalism with a focus on inclusiveness and collaboration, and has been published in the Washington Post, the San Francisco Chronicle, and The Conversation. She recently published her first book, SDG 12, Sustainable Consumption and Production, with co-author and USC faculty Robert Voss. Mick Dalrymple in the middle is USC's very first Chief Sustainability Officer. With 21 years of accomplishment in the sustainability field, he helped Arizona State earn the first ranking in Sierra Magazine's Coolest Schools list and carbon neutrality 6 years early. He also produced a feature film, screenwriter, and an author of more than 50 published articles, and we're really excited to have him join us here at USC. And lastly, Alexander Robinson is a landscape architect, researcher, and scholar. He's an associate professor in the Landscape Architecture and Urbanism program at USC. He researches how infrastructure can function as a landscape, exploring methods to re-envision ecological function and community value. His most recent book, The Spoils of Dust, Reinventing the Lake That Made Los Angeles, is a history field analysis and design investigation of Owens Lake. Thank you all for being here today. Let me just pull up my questions really quickly. So we're going to start. I'd just like to offer Jen and Alex the chance to give us a brief introduction to their books. So how about we start with Jennifer?
Hi. Well, first of all, thank you, Jill, for that great introduction, and thank you so much for moderating. Thank you to my fellow panelists. I was being a little creepy and getting myself totally psyched up as to all the incredible things that you have accomplished, so I'm going to try not to think about that. and thanks to the audience. It's a beautiful, sunny day, and I think there are so many incredible events today. I appreciate you taking the time, and hopefully we can make it worth your while. So the book that myself and Bob Voss, who's over in the Spatial Sciences Institute, were crazy enough to write together is called SDG 12, Sustainable Consumption and Production. I can't remember the second half of the title. Something revolution. Aren't we? We're supposed to be revolutionary. Anyways,
it's revolutionary challenge for the 21st century,
which is not totally inaccurate. So it was published by Emerald Press. The Sustainable Development Goals, there's 17 of them. They're basically a partnership put on by the United Nations to address environmental, social, and economic issues in a way that's integrated in a global way. Global problems take global solutions. They were adopted unanimously by the UN General Assembly in 2015 when the Millennium Development Goals expired. And although the individual targets, right, what each goal wants to accomplish, and then the indicators, whether or not that target is accomplishing those goals, they vary by SDG to SDG, but with SDG 12, responsible consumption and production, there are 11 targets and 13 indicators. And some of these targets include things like sustainable management and efficient use of resources, adoption of sustainable practices by companies, informing the global public about sustainable lifestyles. And as you read through all these different targets, you can see that they are constructed within a very particular framework. There are a lot of mentions of market mechanisms and the role of the individual in addressing climate and sustainability issues. while government support for these things or community scale action is vaguely mentioned, if at all. And if you read SDG 12, if you read the targets, you look at the indicators, how they're measuring them, you can see that this goal does not fundamentally reshape or reform consumption in any real way. There's minimum regulation written in, government support is there when necessary, and it really sort of reflects a basic neoliberal approach to environmental problem solving. The idea that environmental problems can be effectively solved while promoting economic growth and human well-being. And I was telling Mick a little earlier, you know, we strived in this book. You can probably see where Dr. Voss and I ended up, you know, what we think. But we tried to, you know, really highlight the maxim that education is not indoctrination. So whether or not you believe in a neoliberal approach to environmental problem solving, we just really wanted to show that that is very much the space in which SDG 12 operates, and that's going to offer certain solutions and not others. So the book itself does a few different things. I'll give you a really quick description of the table of contents, and you can see if it's for you or not. We start by discussing SDG 12 in the context of neoliberalism. I had a lot of fun with chapter two. We got to go and talk about all the different sort of anti-consumer movements around the world, and I think I'm going to get to talk about them a little bit more later. We talk about some success stories with respect to things like cradle-to-cradle production, products as services, life cycle assessments. You know, there are places in which some of the win-win solutions that have happened under the rubric of SDG 12 have been successful. We look at the metrics for measuring these targets. We look at whether or not SDG 12 has been successful. Basically, there's not enough data to determine the degree to which we're meeting our goals. I actually looked at the data, and on the UN website, the only data is whether or not a country has adopted a sustainable consumption and production target. That's all you can find on how well the goal is being met. So it could use some work. And we basically argue that it's never going to challenge the status quo to the degree necessary to really reduce our material impact on Earth. So we envisioned the book for upper division undergraduates, maybe early master's students. But if you're interested in global development, sustainable global development, green marketing, green advertising, or if you know someone who's not interested in any of those things but has a hard time sleeping, this might be a good book for you to pick up on the way out. That's about it.
Thank you, Jennifer, and thanks, everyone. This is never something completely different. My book is, in broad strokes, not so much about confronting climate change as adapting to climate change. And the book is really about middle ground landscapes that lie between society and nature. And it's looking at landscapes like the LA River or the Owens Lake, which I'll tell you more about, that are under really intensive demands by society to provide health and safety, like clean air quality or flood protection or water. And then also at the same time, we want to make them really amazing landscapes. We want to make them ecological. We want to preserve maybe or restore what they were before we altered them. And so that's a lot of the work that I do, is thinking like what are these landscapes? What are they like? How do they have qualities of themselves, of their own? And how do we design them? And is there a way to design them better? Because I think that's something that we have to do. We have to learn how to do that. And we're not very skilled at it. We sometimes actually succeed, but oftentimes it's almost lucky. It's by luck that we get there. So the book itself is about Owens Lake, which is a lake that you may have seen when you've driven to Mammoth Mountain or in the Owens Valley. It's about 300 miles north of here. It's in the Eastern Sierras, and it's at the end of the Owens Valley, which is the deepest valley in the U.S., and it's the source of about 40% of the water in Los Angeles. So we built the aqueduct in 1913. We took that water and diverted it into a pipe, brought it to Los Angeles. And when we did that, we didn't really think much of the fact that we took the water that fed this 110 square mile lake at the bottom of the Owens Valley. And we didn't think much of it in a way because it was a salty lake. So we didn't drain the Owens Lake, we just dried it. We took the water that fed the Owens Lake, and it fed this unusual landscape. I mean, the Owens Lake defies a lot of standard descriptions or ideas of what a lake is. We drained it out, and we created, but it was an incredible ecosystem and food source for indigenous people there. In fact, salt lakes, you know, and I think I'm getting ahead of myself, it's a salt lake. So I forgot to mention that it's a terminus lake, so it doesn't run out of the Owens Valley. It collects all the minerals in that whole area, and it's a very salty, extremely salty lake. And so we didn't think much of the value of it. We drained it, and by the 1930s, this really dry lake had become a terrible source of dust. And there wasn't really much interest in taking care of that until modern air regulations were able to be enforced in that area. And they were able to determine that the Department of Water and Power, which took the water, had to control this dust source from their water harvesting operation in the Owens Valley before they could do anything else there. And so it was actually an incredible regulatory achievement to kind of make a dry lake considered a smokestack. But the book is really about, you know, how the DWP took this lake and were forced to manage the dust on there. And they weren't there wasn't the option to just fill the lake up again, because that would take all the water in the aqueduct. And it would also take 10 years, and people would suffer for another decade from the dust. So they were looking at, they had to figure out a way to control the dust without using all their water. And then through sort of unlikely circumstances, they are actually required to kind of make a simulacrum of the original lake in terms of its values that it provided. So they created a habitat out of it. They created a recreational resource. In many ways, it was a very unlikely success. But the book has four parts investigating this very unusual case study for how we're designing large-scale landscapes to find this balance. And the first part is really, how did this lake become more than a dust control project? Because that's all they wanted to do originally. And by some incredible circumstances, the lake became a project about creating lake-like values. Like a drought-tolerant version of a lake, you know, like a low-water version of it. Which seems like an incredible, impossible task. The second part of the book is about all the different ways in which we would look at the lake and sense it and think about it and measure it, and how those translated into the making of it. And this is kind of more of there's a series of chapters. One's about bird watching, there's a series of chapters about looking at the lake. So there's dust, birds, and scenery. And one, for instance, is about birds, and it's just an incredible place to watch birds, because there's roads going through the entire thing. So you can drive through this lake and see thousands of birds. And so that actually was instrumental in saving the lake and making landscape values. The third section of the book is an atlas trying to understand what an unusual landscape it is. And it's a series of photo essays investigating the kind of place it is. Because it's a place that people don't generally explore, because it's not a pristine nature, it's not quite an industrial nature. And then the last part of it is an experiment in designing these kinds of landscapes. So as a landscape architecture researcher, I do design research where we try to design in a different way and innovate new ideas, new ways of designing. So it's a lot of different things. It's a little unusual. There's a lot of pictures, archival research. It's sort of an art book, it's sort of a scholarly book, it's sort of a design book. But I think it tries to set a stage for how we might design, you know, the new kind of Anthropocene world of confronting climate change.
So, and I'll just give a plug here, looking through the book, it's just beautiful and really interesting to have all these different ways of thinking about what the landscape is. So,
thank you.
So I'm going to turn to Mick now. You're in a really different kind of role at the university. We have two examples here of faculty who are generating new ideas and creating research around sustainability and climate challenges. What are your thoughts on how faculty and universities can actualize that work to actually put towards meeting these challenges that we're facing?
Sure. Thank you. Yes, I don't have a book, so I feel like a little bit of an odd duck here. But this, thank you, Jill. This is a question that I think about a lot. And I would say there's a couple pieces of the answer. One is, in general, in academia, you're not rewarded for seeing your work put into action necessarily. You're rewarded for publishing your research in scholarly publications that your peers read, and then you're also rewarded for your work being cited by other people publishing works that cite your work. So the probably unintended result of this is that researchers are rewarded for talking to each other, not necessarily to the stakeholders that could use their information. And this really struck home for me when I was in the private sector and I came back to academia in 2010. And I had been for a decade, more than a decade, I had been an advocate for the city that I came from doing something about Urban Heat Island. And when I came into the university, I suddenly found that they had 45 years of research into Urban Heat Island and the causes and the solutions and all that stuff, but it had never made it to the policymakers that could use it. Or the advocates, the citizen advocates that were out there pushing for these solutions. And so, So I really have thought about this issue a lot since then. I'm like, oh, we could have saved so much time, and you know, it would have been great. And I think that there's a couple solutions to that. One is the reward system in academia needs to change, and it has changed a little bit in the last since 2010 when I got back into it. I've seen some shifts, but in general. A couple of things that can happen is universities can utilize that research in pilot projects on campus. They can also use that research for experiential learning so that their students are actually doing hands-on projects on campus or in the community to put that research to work. The other thing is, research to me, because of the crisis that we're in, it's not that theoretical research is not valuable. But sometimes the theoretical research we're doing is 9 generations beyond the research that's actually being applied. So how can we promote more applied solutions research? How can we promote getting stakeholders involved in the shaping of that research? I mean, we should really be researching problems that stakeholders in the community need solutions for, right? So those stakeholders should be consulted early in the process, but then they should also be shaping the process and be involved in the research along the way. And then the communication after the research is done also needs to involve the community so that it gets out there and gets put into place. So this is a big part of sustainability research. How do you do interdisciplinary research? Because no problem is in a silo of a single discipline. And then how do you involve the stakeholders throughout the process? And then how do you have it be applied focus? We still need theoretical research and we want to continue learning. But I personally think that some of the, we have a lot of tension in our society these days, and some of that tension is targeted towards academia. There's this disdain sometimes for academia and, that it's elitist and all that stuff. And I think that some of this is the reason why is people don't necessarily see that they're getting their investment dollars back out, because there's just so much money invested in research that doesn't necessarily hit the street when it's done. And so I think that all of these things would also improve the relationship or the reputation of higher education as being a high value, high priority investment of society.
Thank you. And I really like that last point about creating better relationships between universities and communities. Let's come back to Jennifer. You talk in your book about different approaches to sustainable consumption, like green consumerism and degrowth. What are the differences between these approaches? And is it possible to maintain current consumption given the ecological limits of our planet and the current and future effects of climate change that are ultimately tied to consumption?
Yikes. I don't know. And I would say, I guess I wrote the book on it. Shoot. I can't use that one anymore. So kind of what I have studied during my graduate career has been sort of the diversity within contemporary pro-environmental thought. And so I picked out a few different ways of looking at consumption that might be a little bit divergent from sort of the neoliberal, the economy and the environment are best friends, moving on kind of framework. The first was this concept of dematerialization or immaterialization. It was originally conceived of by Buckminster Fuller. And the idea was that with intelligent design, we could basically create things that use less raw materials going in. And in a lot of places, there's been a lot of growth in that direction. If you look at agriculture and agricultural intensification, there's been incredible strides made in the last 30, 40 years to be able to grow a lot more crops on a lot less land and leave more land untouched for biophysical nature to flourish and thrive. Not everything can be dematerialized, right? I mentioned this to Mick. I think there's certain things made out of cement that you're just not going to be able to make smaller. So it's this idea that we've been talking about the paperless office forever, and yet, you know, here we are. So materials are sticky. And the other movement that is near and dear to my own heart is that of anti-materialism, just straight up anti-consumption. This is the outright perception that corporations are maximizing individual gain and trashing the planet through manipulating the public into buying things they don't need. I was hoping there'd be a little reaction. I kind of feel like that, you know. I used to have a sticker on my bike that said 100% off, buy nothing. But at the same time, like anything else, this comes with some cultural baggage, right? I kind of went down the rabbit hole with this fetishization of anti-consumerism. You know, the folks we watch on Hoarders, we look down on, whereas the folks on the Marie Kondo tidying up special, it's not just tidying up, it's becoming a transformative person. Of course, Marie Kondo, I guess, you know, she wanted everyone to declutter and now has a shop on her website where you can purchase new things to, I guess, replace the clutter you got rid of. And I was thinking about this a lot, actually, when that series came out. I won't do too many stories, but I had just gotten pretty much 80% of what I own destroyed by a moving company. And having to see all the promos for the Marie Kondo, get rid of everything. So is anyone going to, do you have a couch that doesn't spark joy? Because I'd love a couch. But it made me really see sort of the privileged place that a lot of us talk about anti-consumerism from, right? Like, I can get rid of something because probably I can buy it if I need it again in the future. Buy Nothing Day, which comes out of Europe, it's Black Friday, right? So the day we're all supposed to be going and shopping and us, you know, Americans in our flat screen TVs. This was conceived of by the editor of Adbusters, I think, in the late 90s. And the idea is that we spend time with our family and we don't buy things on Black Friday. It sounds great. So a few years ago, REI, the outdoor retailer, they adopted the hashtag opt outside, like opt out of shopping on Black Friday. They closed all their stores. They gave the employees the day off. It's seen as a brand success story. And as you might imagine, their fourth quarter profits were through the roof. So the commodification of decommodification is just something that fascinates me. And one of my favorite journalist and writer Lee Phillips, he's based up in Canada. He wrote a book called Austerity Ecology. And he wrote a little bit like myself, you know, having celebrated Buy Nothing Day, you know, and his argument is some people shouldn't buy anything, but most of the world needs to buy a lot more. And the caricature of overconsumption as buying flat screens on Black Friday really doesn't put into perspective really the fact that there are a lot of people who don't need to consume less. And we need to make sure that as we push for proactive environmental solutions, people's well-being and their livelihoods and their health and their ability to thrive in the world are also taken care of. Degrowth is a political and a technical movement. It was one of the hardest parts for me to write. I don't know why. But it basically has a lot of the precepts of Malthusianism. Basically this idea that we should shrink economies, we should shrink societies, but they're also very aware of historically how those arguments have been used. You know, traditionally Malthusianism, once they say, well, population's the problem, there's some really problematic implications about which populations should be reduced and which ones shouldn't. And so advocating for degrowth can be really sticky unless you're very aware of those social justice implications, which I think most of the degrowthers I know are. And then I'll go quick through this, but this idea of the ecological footprint, this is actually in the text that's used to describe SDG 12 in the UN's text, so I find it especially interesting. And I'm sure, have we heard about the environmental footprint before? It's sort of, and it's this idea of like, if we want to have this level of consumption, how much earth do we need, basically? That's a shortcut. And what's great is you can do it for the individual, you can do it for any scale. And there's a calculator. And there are six different metrics that go into the calculator, and they come from remote-sensed imagery and UN data. And basically, all of the land on Earth is categorized into six categories: crop, farmland, built-up space, whatever. And basically, on everything except for one, we break even. And the one that we don't break even, that makes the biggest difference in how large an ecological footprint is carbon sequestration. But it's not any kind of carbon sequestration. It's not solar panels. It's just forests. Right? So only forests. And that's really the one that tips the scale in one way or another. So basically, in this great paper by Linus Bloomquist and some of his colleagues, is he said, for us to have a one-to-one ecological footprint, one Earth supports our... to do is plant an area half the size of the United States with eucalyptus trees. That's it. We're done. And of course, you think, well, that's not really what we were trying to say. So sometimes, again, you know, subjecting these things to these sort of market accounting systems, it doesn't necessarily get us to where we want. Like, I don't want the earth where half of the U.S. is. I mean, I love eucalyptus, but you understand my point. So basically, that was just a little quick tour of these different approaches, you know, none of which are sufficiently incorporated or critiqued into SDG 12.
Thank you. I'm going to come back to, hopefully, I think you all learned something from that. And there's a lot more to dig into with all of those things that that Jen just came up with there. It occurred to me as Jen was talking that your book is related to consumption of a different kind. The problem of Owens Lake relates to the consumption of something that is an absolute need. And in fact, many would say like a basic human right. And yet we created this really large problem in this place far away from Los Angeles. I'm hoping you could talk about how that particular story can give us some lessons about how we're going to adapt to climate change and the potential climate crisis.
Sure. Let's see what I can do. I think, yeah, there's a lot of lessons from the Owens Lake and the aqueduct. I mean, first of all, you know, we probably shouldn't have done that, you know, like, but, you know, there's a lot of unintended consequences, and some of them might just be worse than what we've created. But I'd say a lot of people actually really enjoy the Owens Valley for having been for all the water being taken away and given to Los Angeles, so the Owens Valley is not Fresno or an inland city. So it's very complicated to kind of parse out all the consequences of these things. I think, though, you know, some say that Los Angeles is kind of at the forefront of how we have to live in climate change because we've strung together resources from all over the region and we've concentrated a bunch of people in one place in a pretty high density situation. And for the most part, you know, to some extent, we like living here, and that it's a success. So the fact is that we kind of have experience in working in a somewhat precarious situation. That the world all over the world, we're going to increasingly see ourselves creating really imaginative ways of providing resources. I think, though, that you know the basic lesson is like, oh yeah, the Owens Lake produced this giant dry lake. I mean, the aqueduct produced this giant dry lake. We didn't think about that. And now that lake could potentially threaten the whole aqueduct in Los Angeles. And there's a lot of, I think we're going to see a lot of situations where we don't have the foresight to imagine the consequences of pretty radical moves. You know, like there's a proposal to pump the Sea of Cortez into the Salton Sea. That's a really intense and crazy solution, and we don't really know what the consequences of that would be. But for me, I mean, I think that like getting down a little deeper into the work that I do, I think I'm interested in the remediation of the aqueduct, and I think that kind of environmental remediation and adaptation is something that we're going to be doing more. We're going to be we'll be confronting all sorts of environmental hazards and be thinking about how we deal with these things in a reasonable way. But I think there's an attitude adjustment that needs to be had with a lot of these projects in the way in which we think that we're fixing the problem. Because we get this single-minded focus about what is the one thing that kind of triggered the concern. So you might have a concern about air pollution, and we just focus on fixing that problem. Just how do we fix it? And we have this mentality that we're kind of bring it back. We're going to bring the kind of situation back to what it was before this was a problem, and that we're going to go back in time. And that's really just not the case with these projects. Like, we're not fixing anything. We're creating a new world every time we make one of these changes. And at the and what I've seen in all these large projects where we fix something, we haphazardly create a new world. We don't know what we're really creating. We don't have a sense of what kind of landscape it's going to be. And from a purely academic sense, that's like kind of interesting to see what engineers, not really thinking about what kind of world they're making, make if they just focus on one thing and not think about anything else. And it's a huge task. So I have total respect and like the challenge of just getting that one thing done, and then they end up producing something that has no intention for human use or engagement. And what I found out is that, like, when that happens, we actually have really poor connection to that place. We sometimes reject it. We don't really take care of it. There's not the stewardship. But sometimes there's something that, like, there's a lot of accidents that happen, unintended consequences that make them kind of interesting places. So at the one of my favorite stories is at the Los Angeles River, which I do research on, is that they had a Conservation Corps calculation about how they would pour the concrete and make the walls of the river. And they figured out how to do it so that they would use the maximum labor, so that most people would be employed. And the solution to that problem was to have trapezoidal walls, so they were slanted, so people could walk on it and tie rebar. It was more expensive and required less labor to make vertical walls, which they would have done, you know, if they hadn't had that calculation. So accidentally, they added this human dimension to the LA River. And if you've been to the, like, Glendale Narrows, that's a really lovely thing. You can walk down on the side of this bank and people have picnics. It's not really, I can't legally recommend you do that because it's a little bit slippery, but, like, most people survive. And there is a thing called the Los Angeles injury, which if you go to the hospital after slipping in a moss puddle, they'll recognize it. But, like, that is got a kind of, that's allowed people to go kayaking in it and engage with it and have an experience in there and make it into a landscape and imagine something else. And at the Owens Lake, it was really a kind of bizarre confluence of this ancient Justinian Roman law, the public trust doctrine, and the dust control methods, where the Department of Water and Power put water on the lake to control the dust because they were just being so resistant to doing anything that their timeline were out of time, and they just poured water on the lake to mitigate the dust, to kind of buy time and to get the job done. And they got trapped in a legal doctrine that said that they had to maintain the values that they created on the lake. And when they put a little water on that lake, it's like a instant life kit. There's like literally the sea monkey species in that lake. And they, you know, like, the whole ecosystem restarted. Brine flies and brine shrimp and birds came in, and it became this incredible habitat that they were just locked into making. And then people were mobbing it, bird watching, and like having feelings about it and having stewardship. And then it became a landscape that eventually is kind of a success story. In terms of balancing ecology and infrastructure. But anyway, imagine if we were doing this all haphazardly. That's the lesson kind of these things. Like, imagine if we thought about what we were doing and were like thoughtful about it and didn't just kind of stumble into making these infrastructures into some sort of place that we might want to use.
Thank you. That's great. I actually think that's a nice transition to coming back to Mick and sort of planning and digging into what are the solutions for some of these issues. Your office recently put forward an ambitious plan to make USC carbon neutral by 2025. If more universities and corporations made these commitments, it would have a massive impact on climate change. How is USC planning to hit the target? And how can other organizations do the same thing? And what can we be doing to encourage other groups to do the same thing?
Sure. Well, I think that we want USC to be an accidental success story. that would be a great outcome. But so the plan that Jill's referring to is called Assignment Earth. That's the T-shirt. We just announced it on Monday. It's our Sustainability 2028 framework. The Olympics will be here in summer of 2028, and so we kind of felt that that was a natural target to try to accomplish just a massive amount of things, including the climate neutrality by 2025. But there's also research goals, education goals, engagement, inclusion, and then other operations like zero waste by 2028 and reductions in water use. And Jill and many, many others, over 100 people were involved in creating this framework. So I think kind of, you know, alluding to some of the stuff that Alex was talking about is, you know, everything is made up of systems, right? And so it's nested systems within other systems, and there's food systems, energy systems, economic systems, consumerism systems. And so USC, of course, has all of these or many of these systems itself, and it's nested within larger ones. And so we're essentially the size of a small town or a city, right? So there's huge opportunity for us to, one is we could go out and communicate with others, and how are we engaged in others? And I get this question a lot, and I really haven't been outside of USC yet, just starting to kind of reach outside of USC. But I think that the opportunity is for USC to be the example. We are an anchor institution in the community, and so if we could figure some of this stuff out, we are a small ecosystem of the larger system, and so we can be that example to others. And in fact, I think that it's kind of it's not a prerequisite, but it adds a lot of credibility to us sharing research with others and sharing examples and teaching students, is that if we're actually walking the talk and figuring it out, I mean, nobody's got all of these solutions, so we're going to be figuring it out along the way. But if we can do that and show success, but then also talk about what didn't work, and put it in ways that can be communicated to others from all different types of audiences, policymakers to average citizens to, you know, how do you garden? How do you create a native plant garden in using native plants in the Los Angeles area? That we have that opportunity, and I feel like we have that obligation as an anchor institution within the community to do that. So that's what we're going to try and do, how we're going to try and get there. So USC has already done a tremendous amount on improving the energy efficiency of buildings, and also has done a significant amount on reducing water use, but there's a tremendous amount more. Alex is involved, and so is Jill, in some of the native landscaping projects that are going on around USC, as well as, you know, how do we regenerate ecosystems in doing that? We're going to, from the energy side, we're going to continue with the energy efficiency projects. That's replacing, you know, fans with, you know, HVAC fans with variable speed fans, replacing lighting with LED lighting, doing what's called retro commissioning, where you're actually going in and essentially providing a building checkup. How is everything actually operating? Is it even wired correctly? When's the last time somebody checked this? So stuff like that, to then solar and renewable energy that we are acquiring from Los Angeles Department of Water and Power. So LADWP has a tremendous effort going on to clean their grid and make it carbon neutral. So we will benefit from that. And then we also go out and seek additional solar on top of that. And then as well, putting solar on our own buildings to the extent that we can. So those are some of the major ways that we'll be doing it. And then we'll also be buying carbon offsets. So that gets into a whole nother conversation about should it be offsets or should it be removal? Can we possibly leverage USC-developed technologies in order to remove carbon and then use the campus as a pilot project so that we can then scale up that carbon removal to other folks across the globe? And then also, what types of, do we want to do local projects or do we want to do international economic development projects that reduce carbon or remove carbon from the atmosphere? So there's a lot of conversations that are yet to be had there. We've got a couple of years to get that part together, but we will consistently over time decarbonize our infrastructure, make sure any new buildings that we're building are built as highly efficient as possible. And then hopefully run those off of renewable energy as well, and hopefully remove fossil fuels from any of those buildings. So it's that combination, and I think we've got this great opportunity to leverage research that's been developed here and then also set an example and be that example so that we can help others do the same.
Thanks so much, Mick. What gets me excited about hearing all of this is these are all solutions that exist. We're not talking about theoretical stuff in the future. If we can do this, then we can make it happen. This is all possible right now. So before we open it up to some questions from the audience, I just want to follow up on this idea of transitioning away from fossil fuels and hoping that all of you could maybe say a few words about making sure that that transition is just and equitable and how we can approach that transition so that it benefits everybody on the planet and not just some people. It's for all of you, so whoever wants to start, go ahead.
Well, I tell you, I struggle with this issue a lot too, because there's a lot of focus within the USC community on what can we do with the communities around USC, particularly on, say, carbon offsets that would help lift them up. So there's conversations as well on transportation electrification, and LADWP has come up with rebates, or LA has rebates for people to buy used EVs, and then also additional rebates depending upon what your income level is in doing that. I think that's a cool kind of innovative concept. I don't think it's going to solve the challenge, but it's going to help. And I think that we need to be thinking in creative ways like that. Could USC help subsidize energy efficiency checkups for homes and energy efficiency retrofits and somehow transform that into a quantified carbon offset that USC could use in a legitimate internationally accepted accounting for greenhouse gas protocol way? So those are things that we can explore. But I struggle with this a lot because, you know, the planet doesn't really care if the carbon is coming from the US Key campus or if it's coming from the neighborhood around it or if it's coming from, Pakistan. So if we could use the same amount of resources to do a reforestation project in Bolivia for $10 per ton versus spending $60 per ton on a project on our campus to reduce carbon. And if we could improve the economy or improve the local community in Bolivia at the same time, what we should be doing, right? Because you want to clean up your own bedroom, right? Clean up your room. It's like, you don't want to go tell other people or, you know, clean up somebody else's room. You should clean up your own room first. But if you could make six times the impact or 10 times or 20 times the impact by doing a project in another part of the world where you're actually also helping that community, should we be doing that rather than spending $60 to $200 plus dollars a ton on ourselves. At some point, the low-hanging fruit goes away. So anyway, so I don't have a solution for that yet, but it's something that I think about all the time, because I spent some time in Guatemala doing some work, and you know, there's tremendous deforestation going on in Guatemala. Meanwhile, climate change causes more floods, and so there's not as much to hold up the soil on these steep mountainsides. So they you know, just terrible mudslides down there. Well, people aren't cutting down the trees because they want to accelerate climate change. They're cutting them down because they don't have employment, and so why would they buy propane? And they don't want to buy propane anyway for cooking, because it doesn't taste as good as cooking over wood. So if you don't have anything to do all day to earn an income, you're going to go out into the forest and cut down tree branches to use to cook food. So getting to Alex's thing, it's not a technical solution. It's a people, it's a cultural, it's an economic. You cannot, and sustainability is not environmentalism. It is all of this wrapped up in one. And so you really need to look at these systems and come up with the best overall one, and know that it's always going to be a facsimile. Nature has 3.8 billion years of R&D experience. We don't. So we're going to always come up with something that's not perfect. But if you can reach out to those stakeholders, and if you can analyze and think of the system as broadly as possible and what the possible and unintended consequences are, then you have a better shot at coming up with a solution that's going to have a better overall benefit.
Thank you for that, Mick. I think that's great. And one of the things I really appreciated in your description of what USC is doing, you know, I like how you talked about it as a nested model. You know, we don't have an individual, you know, it's not a think locally, act globally. It's we're all acting on all these scales simultaneously, and how do they interconnect? And that's how geographers view the world, not as USC is having a boundary around it, but as a place where networks connect and flow, and is constantly being shaped and reshaped by these patterns. So it's going to be exciting to see the ways in which those engagements evolve. I guess, so I started out in biology and ecology and things like that, the harder sciences, and then I switched to social science, doing social psychology, and my advisor at my master's thesis advisor says, oh, you went from the hard sciences to the harder sciences, and I said, yeah, right? And so I guess what I was going to say is, you know, as we move forward, looking at the justice and equity aspects of sustainability, it's just really important to remember the cultural components. I've been working with USC students, undergraduates, looking at attitudes towards solar development in Eastern California, because we do, you know, at Spatial Sciences, we overlay slope and aspect and solar radiation, and it's larger than 2 acres, and it's proximate to transmissions, and oh, great, we've got a great place for solar and tons of public support. Everyone loves solar, both political parties. And then you go out there, there's a bunch of people that say, oh, heck no, we've seen this episode. We've seen this episode with the Owens River. We've seen corporations come up, you know, Bombay Beach. We've seen, there's a one place you can eat in Bombay Beach. It's called the Ski Inn, for when they went and jet skied on the Salton Sea. It was this just lovely place to recreate on the weekends. I love the Salton Sea, by the way. But, you know, the justification, what we found with my student researchers in Eastern California was that it really had very little to do with solar. It had to do with distrust of major corporations coming in and thinking they could do whatever the heck they wanted in the desert and it would work. And unless you understand that, you're not going to get anywhere, even if you have the perfect site. One more little tiny story, but, you know, with the dolphin safe tuna movement, you know, what reduced bycatch of dolphins was two things. One is the back down procedure, where they would kind of move the net a little back and the dolphins could swim out of it. And then there also was a little flap that I guess only the dolphins could get out and not the tuna. Again, we haven't figured out tuna-safe tuna, but that's a different story. Tunas are amazing creatures. So they had this innovation, and it reduced mortality by about 60%. And then basically the U.S. started realizing that they were losing in the domestic tuna market, the fisheries were. And so I don't remember the details, but the government basically said, okay, every can of tuna sold in the United States needs to get this dolphin-safe certification label. And so these three giant fisheries based in the U.S. said, all right, sign us up. We've got the resources to go with the certification. Guess what it did? It gave a huge priority to domestic producers, which was exactly what they needed at the time. So you've got public concern. Great. People like dolphins. You've got this cool little net that makes them die less. And hey, guess what? We could earn a lot of money And actually, Latin American countries sued for price manipulation, market manipulation. But I guess it's just another analogy of the way in which ignoring the social components, the larger geopolitical components, the historical aspects, the ecological composition of an area, you can come in with any sort of whiz-bang solution you want, and it's not going to work unless you know the place on the ground.
You know, following up a little bit on the solar topic, there's a funny little, I mean, there's an episode of solar panel drama that played out in Northeast LA in the last decade or two decades. I mean, it was about a decade and a half ago that started. And they built a set of solar panels on Debs Park, next to Debs Park, above this retirement center, and everyone hated it. It was really just a grid. Everyone felt blindsided, and you know, it was considered a giant eyesore. At the same time that they were doing that, Occidental College was trying to figure out how to go solar, and they were going to build a giant solar panel on their campus. And then the guy who was working on it was just like, "This is dead. I can't make solar. I can't offset our carbon in our oil because this other one just looks so awful. Everyone hates it." So they actually eventually got an architect involved. And the architect kind of tells a story. I mean, he tells a story about basically once the architect was involved, it was almost kind of like the lights dimmed, and the architect told the story about land art and how, you know, infrastructure can be beautiful. Which maybe I try to tell that story too, but like that, and he like redesigned this solar panel setup so it looks like a piece of land art. It has this kind of, you know, curving form in Occidental College. And they thought about how it actually reflects light from the sky, and they thought about what it meant, what kind of the experience that it created, and, you know, were focused on that. And they made something that's not, you know, it doesn't look like, it's not as beautiful as a native landscape habitat, but it's as nice as a solar panel has ever seen, solar panel setup. And it's been, no one really has opposed it. And so aesthetics and like our engagement with these things can have a huge impact on how they get built and whether they get built. Like on Catalina Island, all the power comes from a submarine engine, a diesel submarine engine, and like a freight train engine. And there's been a lot of opposition apparently to doing solar because they, you know, think it's going to look bad. And so there's we can't get some of these sustainable solutions, but. Last thing is just like I have an electric bike and I have a semi-electric car, and man, I feel lucky because it's so hard to get these things, and it feels like such a privilege to like go electric right now. Even if you have the money, it's difficult. So I think we've got a lot of work to do.
Okay, we've got a couple minutes left. If there are any questions in the audience, how about right here in the middle?
Yeah, I think so, and I think that's, you know, there are places, and a lot of times when like it is a fix, you know, like that I think is a like a biodiversity fix, because you have these two isolated populations, and you need to put them together, and that is sort of trying to restore some of the natural order. I mean, I have great respect for the natural order. I don't want to try to replace it, but sometimes we're kind of in a position where it's going to be something different. We have to acknowledge it. But I think that those crossings are great, and I want to know if we can make them cheaper and do them more, because I think that we may have a kind of illusion that they need to look like nature when animals might not care, as long as they have like enough shelter and there's the right kind of corridors. So I think when the first generation of these things were like, we've got these like giant bridges with, you know, all this too much money, too much, requiring too many resources. And hopefully we'll get more efficient, effective methods once we start testing and, you know, doing more research.
I'm not supposed to. I have a student who's doing some studying of deep sea mining, but I mean, well, so what do you want to know about it, I guess? Yeah. Okay. So electric vehicles take batteries, or storage for houses take batteries, and those are lithium ion, and those are elements that are found in certain places. And we know definitely about the destructive aspects of mining on land. And so there are definitely groups of people who are saying, well, there are minerals on the seabed, and maybe we should be going there because there aren't people there that we could be affecting. And what my student has sort of gotten to at this point is that there may not be huge effects from deep sea mining, but we're still in that space of not having an understanding about what could happen, like talking about unintended consequences, right? And so we have to be thinking, in this case and in many other, of how tolerant we are for the idea that we don't know what could happen. And the other aspect of it that I've been thinking a lot about is that, you know, some people are saying, well, deep sea mining would allow us to reduce this harmful mining on land. And I guess I'll just ask you all to think about, like, how likely do we think it is that if we find a different source and start mining that we will reduce the amount of mining that's happening on land? I think that the chances are that we would just be doing both. And then does it really give you the effect that you want?
I mean, I just, you know, doing research in the Owens Lake, it's interesting that, you know, I think that and I'm not, you know, an expert in this, but that you know, we don't have a kind of flat economy for water, so you can't, there's not a kind of a, you know, like the agricultural water is not, you can't just buy out agricultural water yet. You know, like Australia apparently has a system that's much more, where there is more of like a market system of water. So I just thought that was really interesting that we still have those kinds of guardrails, but I don't have an answer other than that. I'm not sure if anyone has any more expertise.
Well, I would just agree with your assessment that it's a problem. I saw this in Arizona before I arrived back here in California, in that Western Arizona, there was a large plot of land that somebody wanted to turn into basically an alfalfa farm for Saudi Arabian horses. And so they had enough political clout that they were able to get through the legislature a bill that exempted them from Arizona's, what was a groundbreaking groundwater act from whatever 50 years ago. And so essentially they're pumping water out from underneath other people that were living off wells in order to grow this alfalfa. It could have been hay, not alfalfa, that then would be shipped to Saudi Arabia. So essentially Arizona was exporting water that it really couldn't afford to export. And it was because money was able to buy that that political decision. And so it's something that I think that the first best thing to do is to shine light on it. And then, but then we have to follow through with some kind of a just political process to stop things like that from happening.
I was just going to say real quick, if you haven't read it, there's a great book by the environmental historian Donald Worster, who's at University of Kansas, Kansas State. I know Kansans are going to be mad that I confused them. But basically, it's based on a theory by a German theorist named Karl Wittfogel. And he proposed this idea that arid societies tend to be less democratic. And Worster took that idea and followed it through the history of water in the West. So it's a great read.
So we're actually at the end of our time. If anybody has any other questions, the authors will be up upstairs signing books. And I'm going to take like one more minute because I want to finish by asking each of you really quickly, you know, in the face of all of this, what is one thing that gives you hope?
Well, I'm hopeful for the work that I'm doing. I'm working on a project to build a giant model of the LA River, and we're going to bring community members, engineers, and artists together. And I think there's potential for us to find ways to work together and create imaginative solutions that are inclusive. So that's my hope.
And mine is that I know, I've seen in my lifetime, people do incredible things when they have a common goal and they see a common problem. I mean, just even COVID in our healthcare system has just been just amazing. And so I know that people can come together and can accomplish amazing things. Unfortunately, a lot of times it's about when the pain of staying the same is greater than the pain of changing, that's when people get motivated. But I see that momentum building, and I think that a combination of people being motivated and economics and technology advancing and all these things, that I think that there's a lot of opportunity for us to not necessarily keep everything the way that it is, but to actually create a tremendous amount of change and create new opportunities.
So one thing that I really liked about your presentation today, Alex, was, you know, this idea of, I don't know, it seems to me like a good Anthropocene, right? I don't want to overly glamorize this idea of, you know, we're in control of all of Earth's systems, but the way you approach it, I really enjoy. It seems like the Serenity Prayer, right? Accept the things you can't change and then change the things you can. There's some things that, well, we really screwed that up, and there's a lot of other real opportunities that we can take advantage of. And what I like about hearing you talk, Alex, is the way in which it almost seems a little bit fun and exciting. Like, whoa, whoops, we actually created a big ecosystem, but here we go. And another thing that kind of I get excited about, and now that I think about it, sounds really boring, is this idea of the proximate possible. So this idea of, all right, I would love to completely make the beef industry disappear, right? I would love to be able to do that. It's not going to happen, right? And no matter if I talk somebody's ear off, probably they're just going to decide that I don't know what I'm talking about and go back to their burger versus have a big life change that will involve them not eating burgers again. So this whole plant-based meat substitute coming to places like Carl's Jr. is fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. We aren't going to get people to stop eating meat, but if they can replace one burger a month with something plant-based, we're making a huge amount of change, higher in the supply chain than, you know, an individual just, you know, seeking out these things individually. So I think that's exciting, trying to do what is doable versus maybe what is ideal, and constantly questioning ourselves and our approach to these environmental problems. And one thing I was telling Jill was, you know, I've been looking at environmental attitudes for over 20 years now, and 20 years ago I wrote reports saying that no one was ever going to care about climate change because there was no clear villain, you couldn't visualize it, it was happening in other places far away. And if you had told me that we would have climate be such a salient issue despite the political system we have to get through, to see this level of agency and excitement from people, climate marches, is just something I never thought I'd see. So that makes me excited.
Okay, thank you so much. And thank you all for joining us, and have a great rest of your day.
Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.